Hi, everyone, and welcome to Analytics in 15. I'm Amy Larish. I'm a product manager for QuickSight Q. And today we're going to cover getting your answers from your data in seconds with Amazon QuickSight Q. So quick overview of QuickSight. So QuickSight is the unified BI for all your analytics needs. You can build data-rich experiences really quickly and has consistent high performance with autoscale. And like all AWS products, it has lower costs with our consumption-based pricing. So what is Amazon QuickSight Q? Q enables anyone to get trusted answers to data questions in the moment using their own language. So I'll say that one more time. Q enables anyone to get trusted answers to data questions in the moment using their own language. That's right. You don't have to teach your users SQL or how to use complicated filters. Q, they can just use their familiar business language and get answers. And Q uses the same data sets that you have in QuickSight, so they're governed and secure. So as much as I love dashboards, sometimes you find yourself in this place where you have thousands of dashboards and suddenly there's, you know, millions of filters on them. And this makes it really hard for your end users to navigate. So instead of doing that, you can focus on designing simple, sleek, focused dashboards and then let Q handle that long tail of use cases instead. And here we have some common use cases for QuickSight Q. You have your classic fact lookup, like what were my sales last week? You have your also classic drill down. You're just wanting to drill down into your data, and that really helps reduce the number of visualizations that you need on a dashboard. And third, this is the really powerful piece. This is lightweight analytics. So this is where Q generates new insights on the fly without spawning a new dashboard. So Q, you can say, what were my year-over-year sales? What's my month-to-date sales? And even answer questions like, why did my sales go down? And can you forecast sales for me in 2024? Which I'll show you in the demo. All right, and now what everyone's been waiting for, the demo. So let's jump over to that. Just like a cooking show, I want to show you the finished product briefly first so you can see what your readers will get before I jump into building it. So let's imagine I'm a university administrator who works with different department heads to get the analytics that they need. And they are frequently asking me, you know, I want this new visualization. Can you please add one more filter? So I said, I'm going to give them cues so they can ask those questions without waiting for me. So for example, someone recently saw this quarterly enrollment trend line chart and they're like, that's great, but I want to see yearly and I want to see it for my department. So now, great, they can just ask that. They can start by saying, what is the current enrollment by year? And now they can see that same data, but it was a little hard in the quarterly view, just really easy. And they can see a peak year of about 2,000 students in 2020. And now they can just add, they can say, I'm the accounting department head. Let me just see by accounting. Great, now I can see it's closer to 300 and it peaks in 2020 as well. I'm gonna go ahead. That's a really useful visualization. I'm just gonna add that to my pin board and I'll show you at the very end what that looks like. So another question I got really recently is they were trying to put together an awards for some professors who are rated really highly. So they said, who are the highest rated professors? And I said, well, you can just go ahead and ask Q that. And this is all time actually. So I wanted to go ahead and do this year since we're doing the awards for this year. Great, I can see these three teacher names, but I want a little bit more detail. I don't know all these professors, so I don't know which department, I don't know what courses, you know, Anthony teaches. So I'm gonna type in with professor details. Awesome, now I can see, okay, this is Anthony who does the communication course and Cindy teaches two different courses. So that's great. I can now give that information to the department who is organizing that award. Again, I'm gonna save this to my pin board. So here, this is the analysis that I have that you were just looking at, and I am the author of this. So I just go here, I see that Q bar, and I just see this awesome one-click button. I'm going to enable the topic, give it a good name. And highly recommend adding a description because your end users will actually see this. I'm copying it from the side here and pasting. And now, just like that, one click, you're gonna see in a second, There we go. It is preparing the topic for you. It is indexing all the fields. It is scanning all the metadata in your analysis, and it is going to create this natural language experience for you. So depending on the size of your data, this, you know, might take 5 minutes, 20 minutes, but we're not going to wait around. I've already have one prepared on the side, but it is the exact same thing, just as if I fast forwarded in time by 5 minutes. So we can see right away that Q has turned on some key fields, and it has added some synonyms for me, which is great. So it added these key fields based on, you know, scanning my analysis, what fields did I actually use, what's important. And the best part is it took over all of these calculated fields for me. I don't have to recreate these from scratch in my topic. But I actually want to add a few more things. It's good to start really narrow, and that's what Q is trying to help you do. So I'm going to go and try to do this somewhat quickly, but I'm just going to add everything that I'm going to think my readers want. And again, you can change things later if your readers want something that you didn't enable right away. And here, while I'm looking through this, I see this took the name from my data set, but I want to give this a friendly name, graduation date, because I know that name, but I want this to be, again, natural language, the language of my business users. So I've enabled some key fields, and now I'm going to review the automated synonyms that Q has made for me. So these look really good. This is, again, focused on, is this the language of my business users? If anything doesn't match, I'll get rid of it and add anything that's missing. For example, I know my department heads refer to this as a student cohort, so I'm going to add that. And again, just do a quick scan of all of these synonyms. The next thing I'm going to review is semantic type. And for example, you can see here, home of origin, Q has already set semantic type as location and a subtype of country. So again, Q automated data prep did that for me, and that's great. And why this is important is now Q knows, for example, it helps with the language. So when I say where, Q knows that this is what it should be using. Another example of an important semantic type is person. So professor, I'm gonna wanna set this as a person, and same for student. And the reason here is because now if my users are gonna type who, Q is gonna know who the people are in my data. And not every field has a relevant semantic type, and that's okay. Just add the ones that are applicable. And we're gonna quickly show you how to review aggregations as well. So here at evaluation score, I know that this is percentages, so this should always be averaged by default. And I never want my users or Q to sum an average, since that just wouldn't make sense when you're talking about evaluation scores or test scores. All right, so once you've reviewed all the fields, it doesn't have to be perfect. Again, as I said, you could always go back and refine things later. Try out some common questions you receive from your users, and that's just the way to get started. So someone recently asked me, how many students are failing computer science this year? So I'm just going to copy that from, you know, they Slacked that to me on the side. So I'm just going to ask you. I can look at the restatement and I see, you know, it's counting students, which is great. And it's getting computer science from the major, but it's not picking up on failing. So I know I need to refine this a bit more so that that question will actually work. So I'm going to add failing as a named filter in this topic. The test score, I already added the aggregation at the field level, so I don't need to do that again. I'm going to say less than, and at our university, less than 69 is a failing score. So I'll hit save. And again, it's refreshing the metadata. It is scanning for all those values and storing them. So I'm going to refresh. And now you can see that Q, I can see in the restatement, it is picking up my filter to students. Okay, that's really cool. I'm gonna add that to my pinboard, but I already can anticipate what they're gonna ask next. Okay, who are those two students? Well, guess what, I'll just ask Q, who is failing computer science this year? And remember how we just said that these are both people? So Q is saying, hey, did you want professor or did you want students? I want students. Okay, I can see these two students failed. Again, that's great, but I can imagine the next follow-up. Okay, well, I want to, you know, get them involved in tutoring. I want to help them out. I need their student information. So let's go ahead and add a named entity. We saw that earlier with professor details, but I'm going to do student details. You can give it a description, personal info. just like any other field, I can add synonyms. Maybe again, this would be personal contact info, whatever you can add there. And I'm going to start adding the fields that I anticipate my department heads wanting to see. And then I'll save. And now I can simply add student details with student details at the end of that question. This is awesome. I can now see that Stacy was one of my, you know, computer science majors. She's a senior. And I have her phone number, but I realized I don't have email. So I actually just want to ask an email. And your end user, they don't need to, you know, have any authoring access. They can just with language add fields that they want, you know, concepts they want to be added. And just like that, I see email added to this table. I can share this visual with my colleagues, but I'm going to also just save this to my pinboard. This is a really useful view. All right. So if you remember that question I asked at the beginning, that was important for my business, I wanted to see the yearly enrollment trends. I want to dive a little bit deeper because I was a little concerned about the drop that I saw. So if you remember, there's a big drop in 2021. So I want to know why. So I'm just going to ask you, I'm going to say, why did enrollment decrease? In 2021. All right, let's make sure. This is a case, we got to troubleshoot. So current enrollment, I just have to make sure that the semantic type is correct. So I want Q to know that this is a dimension and they should be counting enrollment right now. So I'm just gonna make that change and let's refresh the question. Okay, so again, review your semantic types. It's a really good cue to help, tip to help Q understand how to look at the data and how to present it in a visualization for you. So this is awesome. I can see, okay, it decreased 66%. So I get that quick stat. I can see some key factors. So for example, in communication course, it decreased a lot. So I might want to offer more communication courses in the future. That was a really popular thing in that her enrollment. You can sometimes see inverse factors here, like a student name, but I want to dive deeper into some of these things like the professor. I can see Professor Wang. I know, you know, he recently took a sabbatical and he was, again, a really popular teacher. And if this one doesn't, you know, resonate with me as much, I can change this. I can look at other factors, like maybe I want to see how gender impacted enrollment. And I can see that there was a huge decrease actually in female enrollment. So that's something that I would definitely bring back to the department heads. And we would dive deeper and talk about, you know, programs we can offer to combat a lot of these decreases. Lastly, you know, we always want to know, you know, I want to know why. That was really exciting, really powerful. But I can, again, I can imagine the next thing I'm going to get. Like, okay, it went down in 2021, but where are we looking into the future? What's going to happen next? Well, guess what? You can just do that right in queue. So I'm going to say full forecast enrollment by month for me. That's awesome. I can see that there's maybe a potential spike in November of this year, but then it does kind of seem like it's steady state or even decreasing. So that's a little concerning. I actually want to change this slightly. I want to look a little bit further out. I'm going to just do 16 months forward. And it does seem a little bit concerning that it is going down. So that is something I definitely want to save to my pin board and I want to share with my team later. Cool. So I know we've been sharing a lot of things to our pin board. So now is that exciting moment. We're going to check out our pin board. So all of that work, all of that, you know, all of the interesting, important questions I had are all now saved in one place. I can view everything here. You know, if this is something I do put in a weekly report, you can just, you know, snapshot it and you have it good to go. I can also share it with my colleagues really easily. You can rename these if you want. And again, you could always open these up in queue if you wanted to play around a little bit more with them. All right, and that was the demo. Thanks so much for tuning in. As always, you can go to our community and ask any questions. You can search our documentation. And you can always reach us on the community as well. So thanks again and have a great day.